Brian Cirillo. This is my first year here. Most of you just know me as Jamie Thacker's colleague. That's how I myself. Thank you, Jamie, for convincing me to come this year. It's been amazing. When most people think about origami, they think about the traditional crane, the flowers, the things you see everywhere, and not as many people see this side. I folded this, I folded a bunch of geometric patterns like this that I have on my desk. Students love it, they like to look around and ask how I made it. But when you think about it more, there are so many ways you can use mathematics to look into origami. If we just look at that crane and unfold it after we fold it and see the patterns that are created, you can talk about graph theory, you can talk about tessellations. In fact, there are origami tessellations. This is not my work, but I have folded this one once. It took hours, but it was very satisfying, and just the patterns that are created really neat. And when you start looking at this in a classroom, there are so many ways we could apply this. I mean, a fold is a reflection. Many of you have seen the patty paper constructions. You can talk about tessellations. You can make some pretty complex and interesting foldables with some origami concepts. And then you can look at some of the actual math that's going on as far as angle properties or even trigonometry, or even talk about geometric proofs. There are origami theorems that you can model with folding and then prove with your class. And I don't have enough time to talk about all of that, so I'm just going to share my favorite origami lesson that I do in my sophomore geometry class. I guide the students through folding some new origami model. Maybe some have seen it before, maybe some they haven't. And then in groups, after each step, the students have to decide what their polygon is, and then calculate based on what folds we did, what the values of each angle are. And I give them a guide like this to follow. And you have to start somewhere, so the first step is actually what's given. For this model, it is a rectangle. You can do this with any origami model if you can calculate the angles. And then you start with the folding step, the first step, which is fold it half long ones. So in their groups, they have to figure out this one. It's a pretty easy step, but they still have to discuss it and get the correct answer. And then step three, we fold on an angle. I'm not going to go through the whole thing, don't I? Like this, and all of a sudden, okay, it's not that obvious anymore. Take some work. And this is where the amazing discussions happen in my classroom. I have students trying to explain it one to another. How are we going to get this? I have students arguing, which I think is an amazing thing in a geometry classroom. And the discussion, I mean, there are times when I do this lesson where I just stand in the room and close my eyes and listen for a few seconds. And stuff I get to hear is really incredible. Let me show you what I mean. There are several ways to get these answers. Let me show you a couple ways I've seen my students work. They discussed and concluded that those two angles are going to be congruent based on how they were made, and they issued polygon sum, total of 540 degrees, and say that those angles are 135 degrees. And I had some students actually look at this flap that we made and say that's 90 and that's half of 90, so the angle's got to be 135 degrees. And I've even had students say, well, let's go back to the previous step, and they see the linear pair. And oh, it's 135 degrees. And these discussions I get to hear are incredible and really rewarding. You can do this with any origami model. This one in particular, the last step happens to be this concave hexagon. So we have to discuss that, you know, an angle is going to be greater than 180 degrees. And I have to keep insisting, these are just polygons, kids. These are just polygons. Even though in real life it looks like this. And we keep going, I let them finish. And after they've worked on that final step for a while, I do give them their final instructions. And then I turn around. Because during that last step of the work, they actually came down the hallway and put this on my back. And I just, they hesitate for a minute, all of a sudden I start seeing these plants. But eventually, you know, they get the saddle back out, they throw it a few times, and they want to finish the work and have them turn it in. And at the end, right before everybody leaves, I've got all their papers, I do have to make sure to put this on the board before they leave. And that's my favorite origami lesson.